Peggy Shepard, tireless crusader and pioneering advocate, you have shown undaunted commitment to environmental justice and are devoted to both humanity and human values. Your unflinching dedication to confronting our society's greatest problems and keen acuity for coalition building are qualities that we hope serve as guiding light, as a guiding light for Laurentians as they continue their journey into a challenging and complex world. You have shone a light on those challenges since the earliest days of your career. After graduating from Howard University, you became the first Black beat reporter for the Indianapolis News. Your aspirations then took you to New York, where after a career in publishing, you brought your talents to public service, working with the State Division of Housing and Community Renewal. You brought your knowledge of different industries, strong sense of justice, and boundless energy to community advocacy, co-founding West Harlem Environmental Action, We Act for Environmental Justice. You nurtured and guided a small community of volunteers into a well-resourced organization that has been fighting for social justice for 40 years. I know Peggy doesn't feel like it's well-resourced, but it's been a huge accomplishment. You stand against systemic injustice, fighting and winning battles locally that serve as a model for national action. From your first victory for accountability that resulted in a $55 million odor abatement plan for sewage treatment to setting national policy on environmental standards, you have changed the lives of millions. Throughout all of this, you have not just fought. You have fostered partnerships and community academic research collaboratives with medical schools and corporations, law schools and labor unions to improve the environmental health of children and communities in New York and around the country. You have served on boards and advisory councils, sharing your energy and expertise with organizations ranging from the Columbia Child's Environmental Health Center, Mount Sinai Medical Center, the Environmental Protection Agency's Environmental Justice Advisory Council, the National Institutes of Health, the Environmental Defense Fund, the New York City Mayor's Sustainability Advisory Board, and more. You have accrued deserved awards and accolades, including the Heinz Award for the Environment, the Rachel Carson Award, the Jane Jacobs Lifetime Achievement Award, and an honorary degree from Smith College. Yet, all right, Smith, there you go. Yet you do not rest on your laurels. You continue the fight for racial equality and environmental justice and continue to strengthen and amplify the voices of community members who are working to improve their neighborhood, health, and lives every day. In recognition of your leadership and convictions and the extent to which you embody the spirit and letter of the educational mission of Lawrence University, and by the authority vested in me, I now confer upon you the degree of Doctor of Humane Letters, honoris causa, and admit you to its rights, privileges, and obligations. Congratulations, Peggy.
So good morning, everyone. You all are a wonderful sight. I am so honored that President Mark Burstein, faculty and students have welcomed me here at Lawrence to acknowledge my achievements at We Act for Environmental Justice, where we're working to improve the planet one community at a time by empowering people to power change. Good morning, happy parents, exhausted faculty, nostalgic alumni, and clear-eyed students. Hello, class of 2018. You all are the future leaders of this country and its communities. You are the ones who can impact the future, the health and sustainability of our communities, of the country, and of the world that desperately needs your talents. Today is a mixture of hope, expectation, and celebration with family and friends, a dynamic that may instill the confidence you will need to navigate the challenges and opportunities that will confront you at every turn. How you face those challenges will depend on your character, your values, timing, the political environment, and the secret sauce, a lot of luck. So I ask you a really big question. How will you meet the challenges that must be addressed in order to improve life on Earth, in the environments where we live, work, play, and learn? How will you translate your personal and common concerns into effective action? How do we find the solutions that work? The question I offer today is, and yes, I know you thought I was bringing a whole binder of answers today, but no, I ask you all, how will you walk the tightrope from challenge to opportunity? Now, the challenge I have been offered, the challenge that I have embraced, is that all residents should have access to clean water and clean air, equal environmental enforcement and protection. Yes. And the equitable distribution of benefits, burdens, and resources. That's the challenge of achieving environmental justice. And it is a large challenge, one that I had never expected to embrace. So it is justice and equity that has galvanized my attention, energized me over the past 30 years as executive director and co-founder of West Harlem Environmental Action, known as We Act for Environmental Justice. For environmental justice, it is these values that have motivated me to diverge from my path and career as a journalist and editor, and to take a different path than I had ever imagined. Now, of course, there are many, many roads to walk to seek justice and equality. For many of you and your parents, your primary concern is what job shall you take, or will you get a job? And some of you have thought and strategized and interned, and you believe that you know the route to actualizing your career goals, but there are many, many roads to take. And as the poet Robert Frost wrote, "I took the road less traveled, and that has made all the difference. I took the activist road less traveled that has led me to Harlem, a community with an incredible cultural and historic legacy, but one that environmental justice activists call a sacrifice zone." But before all that, I was a kid growing up in Washington, D.C., in Trenton, New Jersey. I remember my high school and college days. I was certain of the path that would fulfill my dreams. I was an English major at Howard University, and since high school, had dreamed of becoming a journalist and magazine editor. I worked for 2 years as a newspaper reporter in Indianapolis, then headed for New York City to work as a researcher for Time Life Books and magazines like Red Book, Essence, and Black Enterprise. As an English major, I realized that my writing skills would continue to propel me into diverse opportunities. After I almost achieved my dream of being editor-in-chief of a national lifestyle magazine, the publisher decided to invest in radio instead. I can't tell you the disappointment of being so close to your dream and having it fall through. It is so important to handle disappointment and turn it into energy and motivation to be proactive in reinventing yourself and redirecting your aims. But that rarely, rarely happens without you taking a risk. So please do not be afraid to take risks. I decided to leave that magazine company, which had offered me a safe public relations job. Instead, I took a job as a speechwriter in a state housing agency. I had no experience in speech writing, but I had confidence in my ability to move into uncharted waters and in my perseverance to make it work. That's really, really important. If you take a stretch position that you do not have experience for, you had better be prepared to get up to speed working into the night, on weekends, and doing the necessary reading or research. Now, of course, that is if someone is willing to take a chance on you. That's where the secret sauce of luck comes in. That speechwriter position led me to work with political government appointees who suggested I attend a political campaign meeting that was organized to start Jesse Jackson's first run for president. In that meeting, I walked in as the introvert, the person who sits in the back of the classroom and rarely raises my hand unless I'm positive of the answer. Maybe you all have friends like that. Maybe they don't exist at Lawrence. But I left that meeting. I left that meeting having parlayed my writing skills as the public relations coordinator for the New York City Jackson for President campaign. So I volunteered and I took a risk and gained an opportunity for political visibility and new relationships that still serve me today. And I gained a political mentor. That volunteer position helped change the course of my life. How so? Well, I went around the city promoting the convention delegates and gaining an understanding of the different benefits and burdens assigned to a range of New York communities. So my mentor, Bill Lynch, asked me, "Do you want to be behind the scenes producing other candidates, or do you want to be out front advocating your own ideas?" The answer to that question changed my life forever, not just my career direction, but my allies, my work schedule, my wardrobe, and my work-life balance. You know, my staff, most of whom are under 30, talk a lot about work-life balance, but I'm going to tell you that Einstein did not work 9 to 5, nor did Steve Jobs, Oprah Winfrey, Serena Williams, or LeBron James. To achieve and be successful requires time, practice, and a mindset where you're thinking about your goals throughout your waking hours. I know this is not fashionable to say, but no one who is successful at their endeavors got there through work-life balance. So your new opportunities will mean new environments, initiatives, and activities. It will be important for you to develop your own sense of values as you join companies or causes and engage in activities or campaigns that may test your sense of right and wrong, and that test your ability and confidence to speak truth to power despite the pressure you may get from your peers or managers. Think how long it took Olympic athletes and victims of sexual harassment to speak up for themselves, yet their voices have helped stop the potential harassment of so many others. Would you have transformed such a challenge into an opportunity that tests the conscience of this country and helps protect others who may be vulnerable? Would you be up to that challenge? One of my community organizers, a recent college graduate, said this. She said, "I live in a low-income Latino community where asthma, diabetes, and cancer rates are high. A garbage truck depot, subway yards, and a bus depot is a 2-minute walk from my apartment. For many years, I believed this is how the poor lived and that this was to be my reality along with my mother and neighbors. But once I learned about how everyday people can create change and the importance of environmental justice policies, I realized we deserved better and could get better. And as a community organizer with WE Act, I have learned that the best way to make a lasting impact is by creating proactive opportunities for communities to assert their own priorities and rights through participatory policymaking. Now, through strong community organizing efforts, utilizing science, technology, and research, through our long-term academic partnerships at Columbia's Mailman School of Public Health, WE Act in the community got New York City to commit $55 million to fix the North River sewage treatment plant that was spewing odors and emissions that were making people sick. And we received a $1.1 million settlement of our lawsuit against New York City for community environmental benefits in West Harlem. You know, a lot of these issues take a very long time. It was 18 years of advocacy that has made the New York City diesel bus fleet one of the cleanest in the nation. WE Act has launched a solar energy campaign, and we've been the catalyst for a waterfront park in Harlem. There are many other such victories in communities around this country that have been made the dumping grounds for polluting facilities. The challenge is global, but the solutions for these issues are local, community by community. But you know, issues are not so big that they have to be left to others. Individuals can act against powerful industrial and governmental forces to protect themselves, their families, and their communities. We can and are tackling climate change, which is the most complex social, political, scientific, and economic issue of the 21st century. And we can all do our part. I'm doing mine in New York City, and so are other activists who have shut down power plants in Chicago, stopped expansions of chemical and oil refineries, reduced greenhouse gases that drive climate change, and achieved relocations of entire communities from toxic sites. Our future does depend on you. Be the change you seek. Being a change maker, it's not about being the flashiest, the loudest, the most popular. Not that some of that isn't a little helpful. But you can support the change that speaks to you and your values in diverse ways, in your own way. So here's the word. Have the flexibility to take a risk and to recognize an opportunity that may lead you in a new direction. Organize your friends and neighbors to address a problem in your community. Seek internships and fellowships that will put you in new situations working on real issues. And don't be afraid to try new work. It's important to learn what you don't want to do as to discover what you love. Be a good listener to deepen your knowledge and understanding. And if you're a white person, do not allow important issues to be discussed without including people of color and people most affected by the issue. And if you are a person of color, my community organizer said, take space. And I said, well, what's that? She said, go into new situations with the consciousness that you have the right to be there advocating for your concerns. And as the poet Langston Hughes wrote, I look at my own body with eyes no longer blind, and I see that my own hands can make the world that's in my mind. Then let us hurry, comrades, the road to find. Thank you very much, and good luck.